looking at that as, why are you here today? And maybe because my street is flooded and I can't get home. But have a conversation about, hopefully, a stem cell reason for why you're here. Go. I know I'm making you work, I'm sorry. Okay. So kind of end your conversations. And if anybody's willing to share what they said or what they heard, that would be great. I mean, I obviously have a talk plan, but I could spend more time talking about things that you might in particular be interested in, especially because you've got such a small but devoted crowd. Anybody want to share anything?
Harvesting your own stem cells versus fetal stem cells, which is out of the country, plus what I've read.
Yeah, we'll talk a little bit about that. Yeah. Anything else?
I have a friend who's a quadriplegic.
Yes.
Given the stem cells that help them.
Yeah, so we will get to talking about some ongoing clinical trials for spinal cord injuries.
Mm-hmm.
So we will talk about that. Anything else come up you want to share?
I thought they were sort of on potential, but Alan says that in China they're actually using them, so I'm curious to know the difference between the U.S. and other countries.
Yeah, so we'll focus mostly on what's happening in the U.S., but we can talk a little bit about what's happening elsewhere as well. This is really going to be a big kind of cure-all for many conditions or not. So I hope to get to talking about that.
Is that good? So what we're going to cover first, we're going to learn a little bit of basic biology about stem cells and about the difference between the two types of stem cells, tissue-specific or adult stem cells versus pluripotent stem cells. And when we have that conversation, you should feel free to ask me about any other type of stem cell that you've heard about. Then I'm going to be self-indulgent a little bit and talk about work from our lab that's geared towards coming up with a cell-based therapy for temporal lobe epilepsy. And I'll share the ups and downs of that research. Then I'm going to look broadly at what clinical applications are in play right now. What's happening, particularly with pluripotent stem cell therapies, because that's the type of stem cell that we work with and that I've been most interested in. And then, time permitting, I want to do a little bit of talking about the ethics of stem cell research and how that influences the politics of what kind of work we can do. So, why is there this tremendous interest in stem cells and why is there a controversy about their use? Well, we've already kind of talked about our hopefulness about being able to use cell-based therapies to treat a variety of different diseases or injuries. But the major ethical issue that we'll get to talk about in more detail later is the moral status of the blastocyst stage embryo. And we'll talk more about this later. Because to make a human embryonic stem cell line, one of the pluripotent stem cell types, you have to start with a human embryo. When you have to destroy that embryo, use it in order to make that cell line. So I just want to point out the difference between the blastocyst stage embryo and the image that may come to mind when people think about a human embryo. That it's not this stage that we need to use, rather it's pre-implantation, a couple of hundred cells, this is the blastocyst stage, and we'll talk more about it. So here's an image that we'll talk about again, because it shows human embryonic stem cells. Here's a cluster of human embryonic stem cells sitting on a feeder layer. They like to grow on top of other cells. So this is what the cells look like when they're growing. And here's my favorite image, which shows medical and advances with a convoluted tubing called politics in between. Because I'd say the other field that I can think of that's been influenced so much by politics is climate change. But certainly there have been ups and downs in what we can do in terms of stem cell research based on who's president, for example. So let's start with the basic biology. What's a stem cell? Well, the basic definition is that a stem cell is an undifferentiated precursor cell that can do two different things. It can proliferate or self-renew. It can make more of itself in that undifferentiated stage. But it can also differentiate into, usually we think of more than one cell type, but there are stem cells that are unipotent that can only become one type of cell when they mature. But mostly we think about either multipotent or pluripotent stem cells. Now, these words sound pretty similar, but the multipotent stem cells are usually cells that are from specific tissues, tissue-specific or adult stem cells. They have limited potential in that they can become the cell types within that tissue, but in general, they don't have a broad ability to become anything, which is essentially what's true for the pluripotent stem cells, that they can become virtually any cell in the body. So they have more flexibility. So more about the two different types, the two major types of stem cells. We have the adult or tissue-specific stem cells, which, as we mentioned before, are unipotent or multipotent. And I just have this as an example of an adult. And the pluripotent stem cells. And they come in two different types. And we're going to describe both of these. The embryonic stem cells, which, as we've already said, require an embryo in order to make. But there's also a new, well, it's not new now, starting in 2006, so it's over 10 years now, that we've had a different type of pluripotent stem cell to work with, and those are the induced pluripotent stem cells. And we'll get to talking about how those are made and a little bit about why they were made. Okay? Any questions so far about these different cell types? So let's look in a little bit more detail at the different types of tissue-specific stem cells. And what we see are right at the top of the list, hematopoietic or blood stem cells. These are stem cells that are the best studied stem cells because they've been around for so long. They were identified many decades ago. And anytime somebody gets a bone marrow transplant, it's basically a stem cell therapy using hematopoietic stem cells. We also have a good stem cell population in the skin and in the intestine. These are tissues that turn over a lot, even in adults, even in us. We're making new skin and new intestine. So we have a robust stem cell population in those tissues. But also in skeletal muscle, which doesn't turn over very rapidly, there's a stem cell population. And although this is now somewhat controversial, about 25 years ago, people identified what are called neural stem cells. So that means that even in us, in our brains, we have a population of neural stem cells. And there was great hope when this population was discovered that it could be harnessed to do repair, for example, in neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or whatever. So those are examples of tissue-specific stem cells. But there are a number of tissues that do not have, in the adult at least, what we can define as a stem cell population. And remember the definition that it can proliferate and that it can differentiate usually into different types of cells. And the tissues that we know, at this moment in time at least, do not have a stem cell population are the pancreas. And this is problematic if we want to start thinking about therapies for diabetes, which we'll get to talking about later on. And the heart. Here there's been a lot of controversy because we know when there's a heart attack, there's damage to the muscle of the heart. And so if there were a population there that we could recruit to help repair that damage, well, that would be wonderful. And people have been looking long and hard for a heart stem cell. And just recently, there is a researcher whose multiple publications on this topic, in which he claimed to have identified adult stem cells in the heart and to harness them and be able to use them for repair has had to retract a bunch of published articles on this topic. And a lot of competing labs have been unable to repeat his data, the data coming out of that lab. And here's a quote which I really like because I teach this material, and fortunately I've been teaching that it's controversial as to whether there are stem cells in the heart or not. There are no stem cells in the heart. Quit trying to publish those results from a researcher in the field. And I bring this up because the stem cell field, more than most, I'd say, fields of biology and medical research, has been fraught with fraud and people doing things that they shouldn't be doing because there's so much pressure from us, from everyone, from the community to try and get to therapies that bad things are done in the name of progress. So this is just one example of that. So let's get now to talking about pluripotent stem cells, and my favorite pluripotent stem cell is the embryonic stem cell. And to make an embryonic stem cell line, you have to start with an embryo. So here, this could be a mouse embryo or a human embryo. And here's the cleavage stage, and here's what's called the blastocyst. And the blastocyst has two cell types in it. It has an outer layer of what's called trophectoderm. This is going to be involved in implanting the embryo in the uterus and in making the placental contribution that comes from the embryo. So it's not going to make the mouse or the person itself. And the inner cell mass shown here. And it's the inner cell mass that will make the embryo and the person or mouse. And what you need to do is isolate that inner cell mass and plate it in culture on top of one of these feeder layers, which is usually some kind of fibroblast. And if it's a good day, then the cells survive and they start to proliferate and they make these little colonies of cells. And if you're lucky, you can passage these cells, meaning you can take them, remove them from this dish, divide them up into several dishes, plate them on some fresh feeder layers, and again, get them to grow and make these clusters. And if you're really lucky, you can take some of these cells and you can put them in your freezer, and you can thaw them days, weeks, months, years, decades later, and get them to grow on another feeder layer and to retain their pluripotent state. Now, what do I mean by that? These cells, because they're derived from the early embryo, which knows how to make every cell in the body, can, under the right conditions, differentiate into virtually any cell in the body. And that's what this little cartoon is meant to show us. So here are our cells in culture, isolated inner cell mass, grown to make an embryonic stem cell line, and they can differentiate into what we're showing here, pancreas, cardiac muscle, skin cells, and we're going to focus in a bit specifically on neurons, the ability to make neural tissue starting with these embryonic stem cells. Now, something that surprised me and I think many people in the field is that you can also take embryonic stem cells and make eggs or sperm. And that leads to us thinking about Brave New World scenarios where you can actually use stem cell-derived eggs and sperm to make human embryos, maybe. Although these cells can make eggs and sperm, they're not all that functional, so we haven't gotten to that point yet. But it's pretty amazing that these cells have retained the ability to even make the germline cells, eggs and sperm. Yep.
Can you mix species with these? Like you said, the mouse, it's human and this is mouse, or even if humans and apes, which are so close.
Right. So you bring up a really important issue, and it's actually one of the ethical issues that we're going to mention later, and that's chimera formation. So when we want to test the potency of a human stem cell line that we have, well, we can't test them by putting them into human embryos. or even putting them into humans before we've tested a therapy in an animal model. So when we do that testing, then we make a human, non-human animal chimera. So people have talked a lot about, for example, if I have a mouse or another primate, like a chimp embryo or a monkey embryo, and I put human cells into that embryo, when does that embryo become human-like and therefore have the moral status of a human versus whatever animal it was? And it's a controversial issue. And because of that, the NIH has been reluctant to fund some chimera-based research using stem cells. So you bring up an interesting point. Okay. So here again, I'm returning to this image that we saw briefly before. This is an inner cell mass sitting on a layer of feeder cells. Here is a colony of what are called H9 cells. These are some of the first human embryonic stem cells that were isolated back in 1998 in James Thompson's lab. And we still work with derivatives of this cell line. So you can go back to your freezer now, decades later, thaw these cells out, and they've retained their ability to self-renew and differentiate. Now, that's embryonic stem cells. I want to talk a little bit now about induced pluripotent stem cells. And this involves a process called reprogramming. And what you do here is you start out with a human or mouse, and you can isolate adult cells from a variety of different tissues. Most commonly, skin is used. And you take these skin cells, shown here in green, and you cause them to overexpress a group of genes that are associated with pluripotent stem cells. And here's one group that's worked, here's another group that's worked. And with four genes only, you can take these skin cells and turn them into what are called induced pluripotent or iPS cells. And these cells are very similar to embryonic stem cells. Now, the interesting thing about this work is that it was motivated by a desire to make a pluripotent stem cell line without destroying a human embryo. So you can start with skin cells. You don't have to destroy a human embryo. So that whole ethical dilemma, which leads to political concerns, is kind of gone. And they can differentiate into a variety of different cell types. And we can use them potentially for transplantation and also for drug design, for modeling human disease. But before we get carried away about these cells, and I have to mention that Yamanaka did the initial work in both mouse and humans, and Yamanaka and Gurdon won the Nobel Prize in 2012 for this reprogramming process. There are problems with iPS cells, and I've listed some of them here. They tend to form tumors because you've activated some genes that promote proliferation. They're genetically modified. So they've got extra genes that have mediated this transition to back to a pluripotent state. And because of that, there could be lots of problems with the genome that we're not aware of. And also, importantly, they don't seem to have the stable properties that embryonic stem cells have in terms of consistently being able to differentiate over and over again. So they tend to be more variable when you differentiate them. So there's also a practical consideration about using iPS cells moving into the clinic, and that's thinking about realistically the logistics and the cost of making a cell line for every patient you want to treat. The wonderful thing about iPS cells is that you could make them genetically identical to your patient. You take your patient who's suffering from, let's say, a neurodegenerative disease. You take some of their skin cells. You make a cell line, and it's genetically identical to that individual. So you don't have to worry about immune rejection of a transplant. But are we really going to have the infrastructure and the money in our insurance programs to support making a cell line for every person? And the answer to that has become no. And people are thinking instead about making stem cell banks in the way we have tissue banks, bone marrow banks, that reflect the different genotypes. And that's probably the route that will be taken. So these iPS cells, although they're wonderful and amazing in lots of ways, and they're great for disease modeling because you can make them from a patient who has a specific disease caused by a specific mutation, and you can model that disease. In addition, a lot of wonderful work has been done doing that. It's not as likely they're going to be used for transplantation therapies. So many of the therapies that are now in clinical trials are still using human embryonic stem cells and not induced pluripotent stem cells. So I wanted to give you an example of a protocol, which is kind of like a recipe, of how to go from an undifferentiated human embryonic stem cell or iPS cell and make, in this case, a pancreas beta cell that's capable of releasing insulin and responding to glucose. Down the road, we're thinking about diabetes, which we will talk about again later on. And there are a series of steps here that involve treating the cells with different soluble signals to get them to transition in a way that reflects the way in which this cell type is made during embryogenesis, the molecules it gets exposed to that allow it to transition through these different steps, and eventually make our cell of interest, which in this case is an insulin-secreting beta cell that can respond to glucose. And here we just see the background mouse work that's been done where you've got a diabetic mouse with high blood glucose levels and you transplant these cells into that mouse and you can actually demonstrate that the blood glucose levels go down because these transplanted cells are supplying the needed insulin. So we'll get back to talking about a current clinical trial for diabetes in humans. In the last several years now, people have started with pluripotent stem cells, put them in suspension culture, which means the cells are floating instead of attaching to a dish, and gotten them to form these structures called organoids. You may have heard about them because they've been in the press for sure. And they're amazing looking structures. So in particular, people have been able to make cerebral organoids, which look like little mini brains floating in a dish. And people are starting to model disease phenotypes like microcephaly using organoids. And I just wanted to show you, these are two organoids, one here and one here, that have fused together that we made in our lab. This is an organoid that's like the ventral or bottom part of the brain, and this is an organoid that's like the dorsal or top part of the brain. And what we can see here is that some of the green cells have migrated from this organoid into this organoid here, these streaks of migrating neurons. And this is a phenomenon that happens during normal development. So we're modeling some of those events here using these organoid structures, which are really cool to grow.
What is the scaffold that you use?
There's no scaffold here. This is just the cells alone in culture, but treated with a series of small molecules to get them to differentiate down a specific lineage. So for example, the ventralized organoid, we know it's ventralized because it's green, has been treated with an extra signal called sonic hedgehog, and that ventralizes it. So you have to, again, use these protocols or recipes that take the cells step by step through a differentiation lineage to make a certain cell type. Okay, So now is the time for me to transition to give you a little bit of information on a major project that's been a collaborative endeavor with three labs at Wesleyan, my lab, Jan Nagle's lab, and Jan has great expertise in epilepsy and neurodegenerative diseases and modeling them in mice, and Gloucester Aaron in our department, who's a neurophysiologist and has great expertise in testing the function of neurons by watching them fire action potentials. So this collaboration started working on the problem of epilepsy. And we started with the idea that epilepsy is caused by too much excitation and a loss of inhibition, a loss specifically of inhibitory neurons. And so there's too much firing, too much excitation going on, and that's what leads to seizures. So our hypothesis was that we could give the system more inhibition by giving them embryonic stem cell-derived inhibitory neurons that would suppress this hyperactivity and therefore suppress seizures and the negative outcomes associated with seizures, because there are behavioral deficits that go along with having seizures. So, sounded simple. Let's see, 12, 13 years later, I'll tell you some of this work. So our part of this collaboration was to make the starting material, the inhibitory interneuron progenitors. And so we spent a lot of time working out a protocol, which is what you're looking at this top line here, of putting the embryonic stem cells, so here is actually an embryonic stem cell colony, into a particular type of medium, feeding it a particular factor, and getting those cells to transition into neural stem cells, so they're going down the neural lineage, and we know this because they're expressing markers of neural stem cells, like Nestin and something called Musashi or MSI. And if we then, later in the protocol, add sonic hedgehog and something called pumorphamine, which is a sonic hedgehog agonist, to ventralize these cells, we can make inhibitory interneurons. And we know that because at several weeks out, this is at 14 weeks, a lot of these cells in this culture are expressing the inhibitory interneuron neurotransmitter GABA. So all these green cells are inhibitory interneurons.
Can you tell us again what is sonic hedgehog?
Sonic hedgehog is a peptide, a small peptide that cells secrete, and it signals cells to change what they're doing and do something else, basically. Okay? So this is our protocol, and this is the starting material for doing these transplants. And let's look at the transplant protocol here.
What's
the ESNP? So that just stands for embryonic stem cell neural progenitors. So this is essentially these cells. Okay? So we've made these cells. Here they are in a dish. And at the same time, we've taken some mice and given them temporal lobe epilepsy by giving them pilocarpine, which causes status epilepticus. These guys have seizures. And the really neat thing about this model is that the animals go on to have clusters of seizures over several weeks. So it's an easily measured seizure activity, and it's one that you could see suppressed if you were able to suppress it relatively easily. So they go on to have seizures over a long period of time, long after you've administered the pilocarpine. So 2 weeks after they've been given pilocarpine, we take these cells and we transplant them into the hippocampus. Here's the hippocampus right here. That red arrow is where we're transplanting them. And then at various times after transplant, we analyze the mice for a number of different things. First of all, using a technique called immunohistochemistry, are these cells becoming mature interneurons in the hippocampus of these animals? are they firing action potentials in a mature way that look like, again, mature interneurons? Are they able, these cells, to suppress seizure activity? And can they restore behaviors that have been inhibited or affected by the seizures? Particularly, we're going to look at memory in these animals. So I've got good news and bad news. The good news is the cells seem to take nicely to the brain. So here's a section through, here's a hippocampus on one side and a hippocampus on the other side. And you can see the cells are red, our transplanted cells, and you can see they've spread out nicely through this region of the brain. It's a, what we would call a robust transplant. And even more impressive is that if you look months later, 3, 4, 5 months later, you can find cells in this brain which derived from that, those transplanted cells. Could we get the lights down a little bit more, Deepthi? I'm really proud of this cell. And I have to, look at that cell. I mean, it's got these elaborate arborizations, right? It looks like a neuron, and its great grandmother was an embryonic stem cell in a dish. Okay, so a human cell transplanted to the mouse brain in a relatively undifferentiated state can mature into a cell that looks like this. And more good news is that they have firing patterns that look like different types of firing patterns that mature neurons display. And there are a lot of different morphologies that we can see that characterize these cells. One more piece of good news before I get to the bad news. The other piece of good news is that in a memory test, which is called the Morris water maze, in which you ask these poor mice that have already been put upon to find a platform in some murky water so that they can stop swimming, and you look at the ability to find that platform in a certain amount of time, the animals that never have had seizures, these naive animals, the blue line here, take very little time to find that platform. Whether there's a cue there or not, they can very quickly learn how to find that platform. The animals that have had seizures but no cells, just a media control transplant, are not very good at finding that platform. And the transplanted cells, the animals with transplants in them, are somewhere in between. So they're better than the animals that received media at finding that platform. So we've improved their memory function by giving them these cells. The bad news, as you might anticipate, is that there is no measurable suppression of seizures. And believe me, we've looked long and hard at trying to see, using various measures, whether there is a difference. And there doesn't appear to be one. So we're working out now why this might be. And there are many possible explanations. So we can't answer this conundrum at this point in time. But what I want to do next is to take a step back and look more broadly. We can have the lights back up. Thanks, Dipti.
Have you tried transplanting in naive mice, not the seizure?
Yeah. So
they are more resistant to the drug.
We have not done that experiment, but that's a very good experiment to do. And we have done some transplants into naive animals, and the transplants do well. In other words, they're robust and the cells differentiate and mature, but we don't know whether those animals are more resistant to the pilocarpine treatment. But that would be a very good line of experiments to do. So even though, you know, our news is mixed, the news has been a lot more positive, and there actually are 3 clinical trials that are currently ongoing using embryonic stem cells, and sometimes both embryonic stem cells and induced pluripotent stem cells as well. And the 3 conditions that are actively being treated now are spinal cord injury, macular degeneration, and diabetes. So let's look a little bit more closely at these 3 different clinical trials. Ideally, what you want to see at the end of a clinical trial is a peer-reviewed publication in a journal that demonstrates that this has been successful or not. We're not quite there with this spinal cord trial. This trial was initiated a long time ago by the Geron Corporation, who then let the trial go because it was too expensive to run. But another company called Asterius picked it up. And what they're using is human embryonic stem cell derived oligodendrocytes, which are the cells that are support cells. They make myelin. And it's thought that they may help repair a spinal cord injury. And in this clinical trial, let's look at the underlined words, at 24 months, 100%, 6 of 6, small, stage 1 clinical trial, very small, not really testing efficacy, meant to test whether this is a safe approach or not. 6 out of 6 recovered at least one motor level. That's on a test of motor activity on at least one side. And one subject had recovered 2 motor levels bilaterally, and another subject had recovered 3 motor levels on one side. So encouraging preliminary data. Right now, they're initiating a larger trial, and they're going to be injecting more cells than they did in this initial trial. So encouraging preliminary results, but we've been waiting for years now for these data. So it's taking a long time to find out whether this is going to be an effective treatment or not. So macular degeneration is a condition that leads to blindness. It's the number one cause of blindness in the developed world. And there's been an embryonic stem cell-based therapy used to treat this disease, and that supplies retinal pigment epithelial cells, which help the photoreceptor cells repair themselves. And this is an area where there has been some peer-reviewed publications suggesting the ability on the part of some patients to improve their vision. But again, a very small N. But now there are a number of trials going on around the world for this particular condition and other related causes of blindness, again, using a pluripotent stem cell. And diabetes. So this is a trial that obviously is of great interest for type 1 diabetes. So there are two things that they're looking to do, that they need to do in this kind of a clinical trial to treat type 1 diabetes. One is to supply insulin-producing beta cells. And the other is that in type 1 diabetes, what happens is that the patient's own immune system destroys their beta cells. So if you give them more beta cells, the immune system is going to destroy those too. So the idea is to protect the cells in some way. And the Bedside Corporation came up with what's called an Encaptra. And what they do is they place the cells inside of this device, which is about the size of, I think, a dime. And what happens is insulin made by these cells can escape, but the immune system can't attack the cells that are within this device. Now, what they claim in the initial report, and I'm getting this information, by the way, from the company's website, so taken with a grain of salt, yes, is that in some cases, insulin-expressing cells persisted up to 2 years after implantation. I should say that they think that the dose was a subtherapeutic dose, so in other words, they need to repeat this trial using more cells that can produce more insulin before they can see an effect on glucose levels. Okay, so some hope out there. And most recently, just over the summer, in Japan, there's a clinical trial for Parkinson's disease. That's just been announced. And this has always been a candidate that people have thought was a good one for stem cell therapy, because we know exactly the cell type that's destroyed, dopaminergic neurons. And we can make dopaminergic neurons from pluripotent stem cells. So it was a natural. There are a lot of hurdles to overcome before you can do a clinical trial. And Japan is the first country to be initiating this Parkinson's trial. But there is a group actually out of New York that's very close behind them and planned in the next year to also begin a clinical trial here for Parkinson's. Okay, so that's kind of where things stand right now in terms of pluripotent stem cell-based therapies. What I wanted to do is change gears and spend a little bit of time talking about ethics and politics. Does anybody have anything they want to ask about the biology issues before we move forward? Yeah?
A co-worker of mine is under the stem cell for his leukemia treatment in Harvard.
So that's probably hematopoietic stem cell based, so like a bone marrow transplant kind of protocol.
So it's different?
It's different. So it's one of those adult or tissue specific stem cell therapies rather than a pluripotent stem cell.
Who's doing the macular degeneration work?
A number of different groups now internationally. Advanced Cell Technologies in the United States, who have now been bought by another company. I'm not sure what their new name is, but they did the first clinical trial, and they published on that now about 3 or 4 years ago. But there are a lot of clinical trials now ongoing, a couple in Japan, one using iPS cells.
You mentioned the negative of the induced
iPS cells,
versus the embryonic, you don't see the tumors?
Not as much, no, because you haven't artificially activated genes that promote proliferation in embryonic stem cell lines. They don't tend to make tumors upon transplantation the way the iPS cells do. But having said all those negative things about iPS cells, people are working out ways of making them better. And I think that in the long run, they will be as useful in the clinic as the embryonic stem cells are now. But the point of using them because of their genetic compatibility is one that, from a practical perspective, is unlikely, because we're not going to make a stem cell for each person too expensive, too time-consuming. You want to go to the freezer and pick out something that matches that person's genotype and use that to treat them, rather than starting from scratch to make cells from that particular individual. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah?
How did you discover where to implant in the case of the hypothalamus, was it not?
It was in the hippocampus. And the reason we picked the hippocampus is that it's well documented that inhibitory interneurons die within the hippocampus during temporal lobe epilepsy, during seizures, in response to seizures. So we knew there was a loss of interneurons in that region, so it seemed a likely place to put inhibitory interneurons.
And the number of cells and the extent of their differentiation program, after which you could implant, how did you discover that?
So trial and error. Okay. We put in about 100,000 cells per side, so they're bilateral transplants, and we monitored the extent of differentiation over time. So at a few weeks you see mostly neural stem cells and very few mature neurons, and then at longer time periods you start to see that the level of neural stem cells go down as the level of mature interneurons go up. And we also had markers for different types of interneurons. There are different.
So the recipient is completing the differentiation program, right?
Yes, but not all the cells are doing it. It's a very heterogeneous population, and that's one of the reasons that we think we're not seeing seizure suppression. Not every transplanted cell is becoming an inhibitory interneuron. Some of them are staying as undifferentiated neural stem cells, and they're not fully expressing their differentiation potential.
But still, the mouse is doing something.
Correct. The mouse environment is able to take some of those cells.
Completely.
And yes, absolutely. Okay, so the main ethical issue, as we've already alluded to, is the moral status of the embryo. What do you think about this stage embryo? Does the blastocyst have the right not to be killed? Does it have the same rights that you or I have? Are there degrees of moral status? In other words, can I say, well, I have more moral status than the blastocyst, but the blastocyst has some moral status? And is, yeah?
Do you get these only from abortions?
No, I'm going to get to that in a minute. So, we could say that, yes, it has moral status and we are destroying it, but it's worth it for the potential to ease pain and suffering and to somewhere down the road be able to treat more diseases. So I'm going to ask a question of you now. And the question is it okay to destroy a human embryo? And there are three possible ways you can answer this question. One is, it's never okay. Two, sometimes it's okay. And three, it's always okay because this thing has no moral status. So raise your hand if you think it's never okay to destroy this embryo. Yeah, I figured it was that kind of crowd. I do sometimes get people raising their hand to that, just so you know. Sometimes it's okay under certain circumstances. Come on, nobody thinks that. Oh, you're an interesting group. It's always okay. This thing has no moral status. Okay. So. No, that's okay. That's okay. We, in thinking about this and bringing up the word abortion, we have to remind ourselves that this is a pre-implantation stage embryo. In other words, if a woman is to become pregnant, she only takes a positive pregnancy test after the embryo is implanted in the uterus. So it's not an abortion. So where are these embryos coming from? Where are we getting the material? And that brings us to most human embryonic stem cell lines have been made from surplus embryos left over after couples have used assisted reproductive technologies, in vitro fertilization. So the couple may have gotten pregnant, the couple may have decided to give up, but there are still human embryos frozen. And here are the alternative uses of those embryos. Well, they can remain frozen, in which case the couple may be asked to pay rent to keep them stored. They can be thawed and implanted by couples who want to adopt these embryos. This option turned out to not be very popular because the donors of the eggs and sperm that made those embryos did not want to see their embryos used by other people. Although this was touted at one point by the George W. Bush administration. We could use the embryos to make cell lines, or we can flush them down the toilet, discard them. So these are the options. So keep in mind that most of the embryos that have been made, in most of the embryonic stem cell lines that have been made, including that first cell line, H9, made from excess assisted reproductive technology embryos. So what I usually do at this point is to add, does your position change if they're extra embryos? But you guys have already all said that it's always okay. But usually I get some people to move towards that when I say that they're leftover embryos that would likely otherwise be discarded.
Do you think that there's any potential to have a discussion with someone who says no?
Yes, and I've done it.
And
we've done it.
What is the...
So usually the reason, although not always, usually the reason is an appeal to a higher authority. My religion says that this thing becomes a person at fertilization, at conception. And so you have to have sometimes a historical argument. Well, do you know the Catholic Church hasn't always said that? And do you know, for example, that 1/3 of embryos are lost after fertilization and naturally and never make it? That people using assisted reproductive technologies know that there are going to be multiple embryos sacrificed in that process before you get a good one that can take. So there are lots of arguments that you can use.
Do people who are against abortion, can they be
yes
to have in vitro fertilization?
Yeah, so there are people who are against abortion because that's usually done at a later stage. They think it's okay to sacrifice a blastocyst more readily than it's okay to abort a fetus at 8 weeks to 12 weeks, let's say. So there are people who fit in that in-between, Republican senators included, who supported embryonic stem cell research but not abortion. That is a possible stance to take with some consistency. Okay, so moral status is the major issue, but there are other issues that relate to human embryonic stem cell research. We've already talked a little bit about chimeras. Where are you going to get the oocytes to make these embryos? If you're going to make them de novo to make a cell line, are you going to pay the women for the oocytes? Are you going to make sure to get approval from the donors before you use them? The sanctity of life versus the quality of life, public versus private funding. And we've already talked a little bit about the pressure to cheat, that this field, the field of stem cell research, has had a lot of people commit scientific fraud.
Why does that even fit into this thing? I mean, why does that fit in? People willing to commit scientific fraud, I'm not sure why it fits into the
record. It fits into the idea of ethics related to doing stem cell research. But you're right, it's different from the other bulleted points for sure. So this is to remind me to talk about stem cell tourism, that there is a market out there for desperate people who have a variety of different conditions, who are going frequently out of the country to get stem cell treatment. But even within the country, there have been examples of clinics, and this is a story about one, that have done pretty bad things. Not just things that didn't improve the condition of the patient, but also things that led to negative outcomes. And the FDA has started looking into some of the stem cell clinics within the United States. So I think that that's a good thing. If you're interested in a potential stem cell-based therapy for you or somebody you know and they ask you about it, the International Society for Stem Cell Research has a website that talks about reputable and non-reputable clinics. So it's a good place to go. It's the ISSCR. I should have put that name on the slide, but I didn't. So just quickly a little bit about the politics. The first human embryonic stem cell lines were derived during the George W. Bush administration, and the decision that was made by his group of advisors was that it would allow federal funding only to work on those cell lines that had been made up until that point in the summer of 2001 when this decision came down. Now that sounds bad, but it could have been worse. It could have been you can't use federal money at all to work on any of these cell lines. You could not use federal money to create a new cell line or to study new cell lines that had already been made. So then Obama took office and people thought, oh, all these restrictions have been lifted. But no. What in fact happened was that he allowed folks to work on cell lines that had been isolated after 2001. And there are many such cell lines now. They had to be on the NIH registry, which means people looked into their provenance, how were they made, etc. But you could work on a lot more cell lines. But you still could not use federal money to make a new cell line. So every new cell line that's made cannot be made with NIH money, for example. That's one of the reasons we had a Connecticut state initiative, which allowed us to make some human embryonic stem cell lines using that money and not federal dollars. And the reason that there's this ban is because of something called the Dickey Wicker Amendment, which is a rider attached to the appropriations bill every year in Congress. And it says that federal money cannot be used to experiment with human embryos, period. There's periodically talk about looking into repealing that, but unlikely to happen in the current political climate. So where do we stand now? What are we thinking about looking into the future? Many of you probably have heard about these personhood amendments. And these personhood amendments ascribe moral status to the fertilized egg, to the zygote. And the reason that they have not been successful in a variety of southern states is because of assisted reproductive technologies. They would ban assisted reproductive technologies because you have to manipulate human embryos in order to have the material to transplant. So I'm going to end there. This is my list of acknowledgments. I want to point out my colleague Lori Gruen, who taught me most of the ethics that I know, and we've worked together on some ethics and embryonic stem cell research projects. These are the folks from my lab that did most of the transplant work that I talked about, my collaborators and folks from their lab as well, and funding from the Connecticut Stem Cell Initiative, which then became the Regenerative Medicine Research Fund. And I'll stop there, and I'll be happy to take any more questions. Thanks.
So, Laura, other than Connecticut and I know California, do other states have...
So there has been money in other states set aside. Maryland is one. New York also had, I don't actually know the current status of the New York program, but I know I've reviewed grants for them in the past. I don't know if that program still exists. So there are a handful of states that have tried to do this. With the advent of iPS cells, the stress became decreased. And the Trump administration has not reversed the Obama administration in terms of the number of cell lines we can work on. So although people were very fearful, especially when Tom Price was the first secretary of, he was on record as being anti-embryonic stem cell research, but he was quickly pushed out because he used too much taxpayer money to fly around the country. And so there hasn't been any questions raised about that decision. I think the Trump administration has been too busy doing all these other horrible things.
So how do U.S. policies compare to other countries?
They vary dramatically from country to country. Australia and Israel are particularly good places to do human embryonic stem cell work. So is China. So a lot of human embryo work involving, for example, gene editing and stuff is being done now in China, which is a pretty permissive environment. Germany is pretty restrictive because of their history. The UK has, I think, a really solid program because everything that uses human embryos, whether it's going to be done with corporate money or government money, has to go through this one panel, this one central panel. In the United States, you could be getting foundation money to do a piece of research and not have to go through the kind of evaluation that you do if you get federal funds to do it. So there's a difference, there's an imbalance here, whereas in the UK, if you use a human embryo, you have to go through this panel. So there's a wide variety of different approaches in different countries. Yeah.
So what do you perceive as the dangers for the future? Are there any dangers in all of this?
Yeah, of course. So no matter how good you think your protocol is for starting out with an undifferentiated cell and making your cell type of interest. If there are undifferentiated cells around that can proliferate, then you always run the risk of making a tumor.
Will that stay in the dish or stay in the lab or what?
So it depends on the cell population you transplant. And so a lot of work has gone into, you have to show the FDA that your cell population for transplant is free of anything that could form a tumor. But is every batch of cells going to be adequately checked every time? Maybe not. So that's one thing to worry about in the future.
That's within an individual, right? That's not, you're not passing that down. Are you worried about kind of the genetic?
No, there's no germline. There's no germline issue. There's no germline issue because we're only treating adults. We're not treating anybody's germline.
Right.
That's a different. That's a difference.
How long before a tumor is detected?
It can be a while. So in a lot of the animal studies, and I'll come clean that we see neural tumors. We don't see tumors from the pluripotent cells, but we see tumors from the neural stem cells, and we can see them as soon in the mice, as soon as 8 weeks. So that's something everybody is worried about, and people are going to great lengths to be sure that that doesn't happen in any of the clinical trials. And there's no evidence yet in any of the ongoing clinical trials that that's happened.
Is that a high probability that tumors will develop if you have stem cell treatments?
So some people claim that that's the reason we should be looking at tissue-specific stem cell therapies and not pluripotent stem cell therapies. The problem is that it's much harder to get large amounts of the cell of interest starting out with an adult stem cell. And there are many, and we didn't talk about this at all, but there are many ongoing clinical trials using adult stem cells. But my thinking about getting to a really good, consistent treatment is going to come from a pluripotent stem cell. But we have to worry about the tumors still.
And you can tell that it's come from the work that you're doing as opposed to that it just happened.
In the person? Yeah, you can tell that it comes from the transplanted cell and not from the host tissue. You can tell the difference because you've marked those transplanted cells in a particular way.
If you discover a heart stem cell tomorrow, how long will it be before
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, at least 10 years is exactly what I was going to say. At least 10 years. People have looked, the most rigorous biology done to date suggests there is not such a cell in the adult heart. However, lots of people have been starting out with a pluripotent stem cell and making cardiomyocytes. So that may end up being the way to go and not from, the problem is, wouldn't it be great if we could take a pill that stimulated the stem cells in our own heart to regenerate? That doesn't look like it's going to happen.
And what were those things, the myocytes?
Cardiomyocytes. Those are just the cells that make up the heart muscle.
Are there animals that have stem cells that humans don't have in their tissues, for example,
I don't know.
Where did we lose it?
Yeah, so I don't know. That's a good question. So the reason that the pancreas doesn't have stem cells, for example, is that beta cells themselves can divide and make more beta cells. So one thing that people are looking into is how to stimulate that process. The thinking used to be a terminally differentiated cell cannot divide. But now we have evidence that certain terminally differentiated cells can divide.
You mentioned government regulations. How big does Big Pharma play?
So all of these stem cell therapies that are in clinical trials rely upon a corporation, usually in collaboration with or relying upon past academic research. In California, like Asterias, they're getting grant money from the California Stem Cell Initiative, CIRM is what it's called. So it's usually a combination of sources, sometimes federal funding plus a corporate commitment in order to make these things move forward. They're so expensive, so expensive. I remember hearing that the first FDA application for the spinal cord trial, 20,000 pages long. Imagine what it takes to put something like that together. Huge effort. So it takes a really long time to bring these therapies forward.
What makes it so expensive?
You have to prove so many things. You have to make your cells animal product free, no viruses. You have to prove, have done all these chimera experiments where you test the efficacy in an animal model. You have to show that before the FDA is going to say, okay, you can go to the clinic. Sometimes it used to be, not so much now, that you'd have to do a primate model. Those are really expensive to do because housing those animals is so expensive. And getting a big enough N to demonstrate anything is incredibly challenging. So, I mean, I've watched, you know, the spinal cord trial started probably more than 10 years ago. More than 10 years ago.
Well, why is it any different than...
It's not. It's not substantively different from that, except at first people didn't really know what to make different about what we're looking for. Because safety and efficacy are still the two things that you're looking at.
When a drug comes out, I mean, you're going to hear it could cause tumors, it could cause...
Right,
hear all that.
Right, like in the TV commercials, yeah.
TV commercials. So
exactly.
Sometimes we get different because the molecule is stable.
Right. So people are more concerned about the negative impact that cells could have versus a drug. So things are being pushed through faster now. Whether that's a good thing or not, I'm not sure.
Is the number of passages of an adult stem cell the same as
They're more restricted in their proliferative ability than the pluripotent cells are. They are. They're kind of more programmed to have a finite number of cell divisions. So that's one of the reasons it's harder to get a large population of those cells to use for a clinical trial.
And one question about the tumors is, I'm sure some people are thinking about when they're using the IPS genes, do they give tumor suppressor genes?
Yes.
And how does that
has been talked about, and people have looked at P53 in particular in regards to that. So yeah, the hope is that there'll be a way of dealing with that, and also that there'll be a way of making the iPS cells in the first place that doesn't involve overexpressing genes that promote proliferation. That may not be a necessary step in making the cells.
Do you see a difference between the way these cells that are the ones that are not from embryos, but that the ones that are,
the iPS cells,
yeah, the ones that you see in adults versus the ones you see in children.
So if I'm going to make an iPS cell line, is there a difference if I make it from adult cells versus a child cells or an embryo cells? And the answer to that is probably not. Probably not.
What
tissue specific is kind of, I think, more important than adult versus younger.
So the fact that the cell, adult cells have gone through so many.
You're reprogramming them, which is, and one of the things involved in reprogramming them is changing their epigenome. So for those folks who know kind of what epigenetics is, you're kind of erasing all that history. And that's one of the reasons that this works. I should say that reprogramming is inefficient most of the ways that it's done. So very few cells in your cell in your dish are going to make that transition. But enough do it that you can select for them and make a lot of cells from them. But it's an inefficient process.
Thank you very much, Laura.
Thank you.